Hello, my name is David Andrew. I'm a neuroscientist at Queen's University. I've published about 65 peer-reviewed papers on epilepsy, stroke, head trauma, and more recently I'm interested in the persistent vegetative state and how the higher brain is more susceptible to damage than the lower brain. Now, I've also taught neuroscience to life science students, medical students, and grad students for over 30 years. And I'm busy establishing a new graduate course called Controversies in Neuroscience. And this topic that I'll tell you about today, hopefully in general and straightforward terms, is one of those topics that is in the course. So I'm interested in getting this out to people in general and also using the tape for teaching purposes to my students. It's more general information about what neuroscience currently has to say about abortion and personhood. And while I can't speak for all neuroscientists, I think most would agree with where I'm going in this talk. So I'll also try to provide scientific references while I'm providing information. So I became interested in this topic and wrote an article way back in 1992 for the Toronto Star, and this is the title projected, the title of the paper. And since then, this article's been on the web, and I was contacted by a Roman Catholic school affiliated with Colorado State University to participate in a debate last summer. And the debate was called, How Can Neurobiology Inform the Political Issue of Personhood? My side of the debate was to argue that personhood begins sometimes after conception or fertilization in the human fetus. Dr. Maureen Condix, I think, had a more challenging side of the debate to argue, which was that personhood begins very close to or just after fertilization or conception. So we had that debate, and this talk has really come out of that. So it's interesting that this is the kind of the preamble for our debate in Colorado, and you can read it at your leisure, but the most interesting thing to me is actually that there's this presumption that person and personhood are basically the same term. And it's not really true. In law, person is an individual with standing before the courts. I think most of us would agree that personhood is something more, and even people that believe that personhood begins near or roughly after fertilization would argue that there's a personhood before birth. So there's personhood before a person. So I'll come back to this in a little while. First of all, I think we need to define some basic terms dealing with reproduction, just to make sure we're all on the same page. So during development of the early human organism, we have, first of all, ovulation. It's the ovary sheds a mature egg. It enters the fallopian tubule, and there it meets a sperm that's been deposited in the uterus, and this leads, of course, to fertilization. Over the next few days, there's the fertilized ovum divides. There's a formation of the zygote, the blastocyst, and eventually the embryo. And at day six, the embryo, roughly day six, the embryo implants in the uterine lining and continues to develop. There's differentiation of the tissues, and by week 10, we call that formed human organism a fetus. So all religions consider fertilization an essential and near mystical event in terms of development. It's the union of the sperm and egg, and in fact, many religions claim that this is what defines when a person is created. That's long before science had much input to that. But in fact, science has shown us recently that fertilization isn't really even required to initiate the creation of a new individual. So The example here is in 2005, there were a number of farm animals that have been cloned. The domestic dog came shortly after that, around 2005. And in this case, we have the way it's been created is that we have a mother dog that donates an egg. And the egg is then has its nucleus removed. The nucleus has the genetic material, the DNA, of that mom dog. We then take that plasma membrane, it now doesn't have genetic material in it, or at least not much, and we add to it the nucleus from a skin cell. In this case, it was donated by the daddy dog, shown here in the picture on the left. And that nucleus is then put into the egg, and it then develops under the right chemical configuration into a perfectly healthy puppy in a surrogate mother. And it turns out the puppy is the dad's clone. So it's basically a twin of the dad, and you can see him here on the right. These two are genetically identical, and no fertilization has occurred to actually create this puppy. We can go even further than that, and this is more hypothetical now because this hasn't been done in people, but it's easy enough to do. The technology is there, if you would ever want to. We can take Jane's egg cell and do the same thing. Take out the nucleus, and Jane's DNA is now not in the picture. And we can take a skin cell from Mary, take the nucleus out of that, and do the same situation again, where the blastocyst develops, and then it's implanted in a surrogate mother, in this case, Sue. And 9 months later, we have Mary's clone. So in both these conditions, there's been neither a sperm nor an egg. There's been no fertilization, and yet we get a perfectly viable human being. So for some religions, fertilization signifies when personhood begins. And what do the great religions say about the acquisition of personhood? So there's this concept of ensoulment. It's actually, it's a good synonym for the acquisition of personhood. And it was developed by Aristotle. And he actually talked about progressive ensoulment. He thought that the fetus first had a vegetative soul, then an animal soul, and finally a human soul. So this, he coined this term ensoulment, and religions differ significantly on when ensoulment occurs. So I've created this chart here, and I want to make clear that the definition of a person is different from, or at least is separate from, the definition of a human organism. Again, a person is an entity born and then dies. So I've labeled the earlier stage as a human organism. So the stages are mapped out here, and the question is, when does ensoulment occur? So if you're an evangelist, Baptist, Catholic, Eastern Orthodox, Sikh, then your religion tells you that that fertilization has occurred and that we now have an instant person. With Muslims, according to the Quran, it's actually personhood or ensoulment doesn't occur until partway through fetal development, about halfway through, when we get something called quickening, where the mother actually senses the baby moving. That's called quickening. Somewhat later than that, and extending into later gestation, we have non-evangelic Protestants and Jews that feel that the personhood develops somewhat later in fetal life. And then finally we have, Hindus and Buddhists both religions believe that personhood begins immediately at or near fertilization. But these are, the what people, the individual stances are actually very considerably with the sacred dogma. So it's the old story of not everybody follows their religion to a T. Now, I want to make clear here that all religions have historically hated birth control and particularly loathe abortion. You can't perpetuate a religion and keep the coffers full unless your members are reproducing like mad. And also a disclaimer for me, I'm no religious scholar, obviously. I was raised a part-time Protestant, but at 20 years old, I accepted neuroscience into my life. So please bear with me on the religious aspects of this talk. So what do the great religions say about the acquisition of personhood? Well, there's no agreement. Maybe we should be looking somewhere else if we want to figure out when personhood begins. I want to look particularly, just for a second though, at Catholicism. So we've got this, what I call arbitrary ensoulment in Catholicism. So from between 300 and 1600 AD, there was this kind of general acceptance that the human being did not come into existence exactly at conception or shortly after, but some weeks later. And that was called delayed ensoulment. 400 AD, this was advocated by St. Augustine. 400 years later, however, Pope Stephen V said abortion was prohibited at any stage of pregnancy. But then, following Catholic canon law, it was followed that he is not a murderer who brings about abortion before the soul is in the body. So again, we have this delayed ensoulment idea, backed up by Pope Innocent III and St. Thomas Aquinas. Fetus does not have a soul until quickening. Then things are reversed again. So Pope Sixtus V basically abolished abortion and proposed death, but cooler heads prevailed in terms of killing women that had an abortion. He wasn't around too long. By 1590, Pope Gregory the 14th was saying that a fetus does not have a soul until quickening again. So, but then delayed ensoulment was abandoned around 1600, and that's the way it's been ever since. So we've got this mixed signals here from the church hierarchy. So, I mean, this wasn't really God changing his mind on what is moral behavior. In fact, there's no mention of abortion in the Christian Bible. Rather, these were personal beliefs and political decisions dictated by senior churchmen, and I stress the word men here. So as I see it, there's three problems associated with instant personhood. First of all, what I call the mass murder problem. If we accept that ensoulment occurs right around or just after fertilization, then all girls and women that who abort commit murder. Anyone that helps them commits murder. Parents having a child by in vitro fertilization commit murder because a number of embryos are created and not used, so the embryos die. Anyone that helps them with the IVF procedure is a murderer. And then finally, because only 3 of 10 human blastocysts implant, God allows 70% of potential children to die. So, well, I, in my debate, it was noted by my worthy opponent that when I stated this, that, well, God is just weeding out the embryos that won't make it. So my first answer is, you know, wait a minute, he's God. How is he managing to screw up 7 out of 10 embryos in the first place? And then the second answer, of course, is that everyone is not weeded out. There's lots of children are born with problems. Whether it's congenital heart disease or autism or hundreds of other issues. So the second problem is something I call the no-brain problem. So here's an ultrasound of mom's tummy at about 7 weeks gestation. So these embryos are about 7 weeks old, and you can see the size down there on the, in the lower left figure. Here are the exact same twins at 4 years of age. So the question is, are these two states equivalent? And as a brain scientist, I think I would answer in my most authoritative voice, are you freaking kidding? A few hundred cells on the left is equivalent to the brains of these two kids on the right, each brain consisting of a few billion neurons, each making trillions of connections with each other. So, but a criticism could be, yeah, well, okay, maybe they're different, but the embryos on the left have the potential for personhood, and therefore they essentially have personhood. Well, that's like saying that the plans of a house that you use to in the architectural drawings are equivalent to the house. The plans, the fetuses on the left, each do have a DNA plan. They have a potential to become a human, but they're no more of a human being than the plans of a house are a house. So I like this analogy of a house in terms of the development of personhood. Imagine you're walking along the street and you see that there's a big hole in the ground. Someone's constructing a future house, and you walk by every day and there's some foundation and there's some concrete poured, frame goes up, and at some point you walk by and you realize there's a house. But if you think back on it, there was no point when you said, aha, there's a house, and the day before there was no house. It's a gradual conversion from a non-house to a house. And personhood, I think, is the same way. And again, we'll talk about that a little more. So the third problem with instant personhood, and that is personhood created just after fertilization, is that it ignores a wealth of science. So what I want to do is ask the question here, can science offer a non-religious and non-political alternative to try and define personhood? And the other question I want to answer is, why should we even have an opinion? Why should we care? So that second question first. We should care because how science defines personhood affects how legislators seek to control abortion and abortion limits. So there's a recent paper that's cited showing that many U.S. laws restrict abortion based on gestational age, and that new state laws going against Roe versus Wade are lowering limits further. And the most common reason for delay, pathetically, is the mother has to raise money for travel to leave the state and have an abortion in a more liberal state. And it turns out the women that are most affected and have to delay their abortion the longest are the young and poor and less educated. I mean, this is patently unfair. And the other reason scientists should care is because to date, the only neuroscientist who's actually been recruited by U.S. politicians to inform the U.S. Congress about when personhood begins is a neuroscientist who believes that personhood begins just after fertilization. So I'm going to propose a definition of personhood that's a little more critical than the one that she's proposed, and I will talk about her proposal in a moment. And I'm going to argue that it's the neural circuitry in our brains that assemble during the second half of gestation that really helps us define personhood. And my rationale is consistent with statements made by the American Medical Association and these two groups of obstetricians and gynecologists. And I'll post their statements on my website once I get it up. So I'm a member for 30 years of a society called the Society for Neuroscience. And this is consists of about 40,000 neuroscientists throughout the world. And the idea is that they're supposed to promote public information and general education about neuroscience discoveries and raise debate about ethical issues. They're also supposed to inform legislators, I'm reading here, about neuroscience research and their implications for public policy, societal benefit, and continued scientific progress. Well, in fact, what they do is lobby US politicians for money to support neuroscience research, which is great. But they also don't want to irritate the the politicians. So there's essentially been nothing that's come out of the Society for Neuroscience in terms of abortion, personhood, and even though these are big issues in the US for the last 30 years. So I'm going to define, or try to define, personhood. And the first thing I want to make clear is that, and I said earlier, is that personhood is not equal to the term person. I would define it as the acquisition of cognition, and along with that, the development of a huge amount of memory in our higher brain. Now, cognition, what's that? Well, it's a process of knowing. So all these, you kind of know what it is, just it's awareness, self-reflection, reasoning, etc. Higher thought processes. And for that to occur, you need also massive memory storage. And there's some very particular human traits that come out of that. massive memory and cognition, hand-eye coordination, complex language, intricate social skills. But these are not absolutely required in terms of a definition of personhood, because a person who is, for example, quadriplegic won't have exquisite hand-eye coordination, but they're still a person. So there's lots of ways that these human traits can be kind of neutralized by brain trauma or brain injury. Really what comes down to personhood is this ability to cognate and massive memory storage. So I'm proposing a timeline here. When does personhood develop? So something called the neocortex, which I'm going to tell you about a lot more in a moment, develops around halfway through gestation. And we'll get back to that in a minute. And so this neural circuitry that develops is really the substrate for our personhood, I would propose. And it's under construction all through the second part of gestation. And it's not until shortly after birth that personhood really emerges. If you have your own kids, you know that. You know, they're kind of blobs the first couple of months, but pretty soon you start to see little inklings of their personality that are going to be around the next 30 years, or 60 years, or 80 years. And that's when personhood is emerging. So personhood is a gradual developing thing that really comes to full fruition early in the teens, because our brain is still developing then. But personhood can also fade. So think about when an older person has Alzheimer's disease, so dementia. They start to lose their ability to remember. They lose their ability to socialize. All the traits that kind of create, that have made up their personhood, they start to lose bits of it. More dramatically, if there's major injury to the higher brain, then you can lose essentially every aspect of what it means to be a person, or at least what it means to have personhood. So if you suffer a traumatic, let's say you have a sudden cardiac arrest, so blood is deprived to your brain, globally. Well, what happens is that the higher brain is more susceptible to damage, and that area is destroyed. And this leads to what's called the persistent vegetative state, where the patient is awake but not aware. They have lost all their personhood qualities, but they're still a person. And that's the important point here. So a good part of this higher brain is called the neocortex, and I want to tell you about the neocortex because I think it correlates with when our personhood is created and when it is lost. So it's comprised of several layers of nerve cells over the surface of our higher brain, and it's really like a sheet of gray matter, just a few millimeters thick. And if you stretched out this gray matter on the floor, it would be about 10 square feet in area. And even though a couple millimeters thick, it has, well, millions and millions of neurons that are communicating with each other in that sheet that's 10 square feet thick. So neurons, millions and millions of neurons interconnected with each other and firing electrical signals amongst each other. And the prefrontal cortex really houses our most human traits. So it's the last region to arise, last neocortical region to arise in the fetal brain. It's the last region to actually complete development in the teenage brain, which can explain a few things if you have a teenager, because this area generates personality, insight, and foresight. And there's particular areas we know about. So more laterally there, and at the front of the brain, there's this region that's important in attention, another region lower down involved with judgment, and more medially and orbitally, we have areas involved with emotional responses. These are all areas of neocortex that have very particular important functions in how our personhood is elaborated. So it's the computations of this vast cellular network that give us our distinctly human traits, as I've already described, cognition and memory storage leading to these very discrete human characteristics. But how do we know this? I mean, we need some scientific evidence that this is the case. And one piece of evidence is that we know that when we lose our personhood, we also seem to lose our lots of areas of neocortex. And an example would be Alzheimer's disease, where we have a healthy brain on the left and a shrunken Alzheimer's brain on the right. And you can see over on the right side that the neocortex, this sheet of gray matter, is atrophied. And the neurons have actually died, and this is why the neocortex is withered. And in fact, it's not just the neocortex that withers, it's all your life experiences, your memories wither with it. So even though a patient with advanced Alzheimer's, advanced dementia, is still a person, their personhood is really compromised. So another piece of evidence that neocortex is important in personhood is the fact that if there is some sort of developmental problem with the neocortex developing, our personhood doesn't develop either. So over on the left, at 7 weeks, we have the primitive brain of a fetus, and there's these progenitor cells. They're not neurons, but they will become neurons as they migrate to the right, following those red arrows, to what will be the neocortex that starts to develop at 8 weeks, but then is really starting to flourish at 22 weeks. If we don't get migration of those progenitor cells, then the brain ends up being smooth. The human brain ends up being smooth, as we see over on the right here. The LIS stands for lissencephalic, which means smooth-brained. And without migration, there is no neocortical development, and the fetus, if they're born, is profoundly retarded and won't live long, and they always die. Okay, more evidence that the neocortex is important in personhood. As the neurons in the neocortex develop, so does the personhood. So if we look over here on the left at 4.5 months gestation, so 19 weeks gestation, those progenitor cells have just arrived, and the cells are starting to become neurons, but they're not talking to each other yet. They're not electrically they're not firing electrical signals. They're not chemically sending transmitters to each other. That is, however, going on full force at 7 months in the middle diagram. And it continues on, this continued development of connections and branching of the neurons well into 6 months and even even into the teenage years and part of the, for example, in the prefrontal cortex. So we kind of put this together here. Here's what our milestones look like. At 4.5 months of gestation, there's really no cortex functioning. 7 months, though, it's starting to accelerate, lots of cells, and by 6 months, we have a fully functional cortex, neocortex. If we look in more detail at the actual processes of these neurons, we see that they gradually start talking to each other, so sending chemical signals via synapses to each other, beginning at about 5 months. But based on the little dots, the spines there, and the lines, these become more numerous at 7 months and then into the newborn, and even more numerous in the two-month infant. And this represents chemical synaptic input to these neurons in the neocortex. So the neurons are really talking to each other, not much at 5 months, but they're going full force at 5 months gestational, but doing a lot of talking at 2 months following birth. So we can. There's also been some studies done recording electrical activity in the premature infant cortex, neocortex. There is some asynchronous EEG activity at 24 weeks, but nothing like we see at birth. This implies that there's really not very elaborate pain perception of any sort before about 29, 30 weeks. And that's an article in the journal, the American Medical Association, which I will reference. It seems like the neocortex is not actively involved in perceiving what we see in the visual part of our brain until gestational weeks 34 to 36, so very late in development. So coordinated electrical activity isn't really that obvious in the neocortex until late in gestation. So to summarize the evidence that neocortex is responsible for our personhood, we lose our intelligence and memory when we lose neocortex. We can't have our human traits arise if the neocortex doesn't develop. And as neocortical neurons develop, so we see our personhood does. So this is all pretty standard neuroscience, but not for every neuroscientist, apparently. So the woman I debated in Colorado is named Maureen Kondik, and she testified before the U.S. Congress, regarding one of their bills, the Pain-Capable Unborn Child Protection Act, in 2013. This is basically a move by the Republican Congress to undermine Roe versus Wade. So it was established in 73 that a mother has a fundamental right to an abortion if she decides that's what she wants, and that the state governments cannot limit that right unless there's compelling state interests. And the bill had an out for the states in that after 24 weeks, the state could have an interest, could at least lay claim to an interest of somehow protecting the fetal life or the life of the mother. So this was a bill that was actually that Dr. Condit testified using her neuroscience knowledge to support. And the bill, she testified in May. The Republican Congress actually passed the bill in July, and it basically says that the fetus at 20 weeks is susceptible to pain and the states can intervene. And that essentially undermines the longstanding Roe versus Wade decision, and it's kind of the thin edge of the wedge. Now, the good thing is, if at least as far as I'm concerned, is that the Democratic Senate was never going to pass this bill, and Obama has said that he would veto it even if it was passed by the Senate. If the Republicans get in next time, I just want to say I'm glad I'm Canadian. So pretty standard developmental milestones here of at the neuronal level as to when neurons develop. And I've kind of superimposed on top there my idea of when personhood develops, starting in the second trimester and developing through the third. So we have so this is a pretty standard textbook procedure or diagram, and I just want to compare that to some of Dr. Condit's testimony. So she says the brain is wiring itself in the first trimester well before reaching fetal stage of life. But if you look at the first trimester on top there, yes, there's a few neurons, and they've actually, a few of them have started to migrate, but they're not really making connections until later in the second trimester. So I don't know what she means by wiring, but I think she's referring to if there is some hooking up of neurons, it's in the primitive brainstem and spinal cord. But the higher brain hasn't even begun to develop yet in the first trimester. Even more bizarre is that she says there's a strong scientific evidence for communication between neurons of the brain in the seventh week. Well, I mean, again, look at the diagram. 7 weeks, we've got a few neurons. Maybe we even have a synapse or two in the brainstem and the spinal cord. But again, there's no higher brain. So I won't spend my time going through this. Here's some of her comments or the testimony to Congress in black type, and my responses are in blue. Let's just skip that and get to more general testimony and my criticism. So she describes the lower brain development but ignores higher brain development, which lags far behind, in months behind the lower brain and spinal cord development. She repeatedly implies that primitive cellular structure is present, and therefore that means that implies that higher brain function is present too, and that's just not the case. She discusses pain detection but not pain suffering. And she made this quote, which I actually agree with, and that there's agreement that pain is detected by the fetus in the first trimester, but the debate concerns how the pain is experienced. And that's exactly right, because detecting pain is not the same as suffering pain. So I'm going to just explain this here very briefly. So we have, imagine down the lower right there, some pain input, say from your hand touches a stove, and you retract it. And you retract it before that information has even gotten to your brain. But it is, that information does ascend to the thalamus and then spreads out. And it goes to a particular part of the brain that tells you in green type there how much pain you're sensing and where. But the actual suffering of the brain is not in that region. It's in a region further forward. And you need millions of neurons to actually experience and suffer pain. A snail can detect pain. A fetus can detect pain. A snail does not suffer pain. A fetus does not suffer pain because it does not have enough neurons to experience suffering, at least not in the first two trimesters. Now, third trimester, maybe they may be experiencing some pain. We're going to talk about that, though, because it turns out that the fetus is sedated naturally in the womb. We'll come to that later. So just to emphasize this point, that detecting pain is not the same as suffering pain. If you touch a stove, you'll have this reflex arc where your hand retracts. And this is long before your brain has been informed about what's going on, because this is actually a reflex arc. Information is going in and coming out. And that's the way the fetal brain works. There's no higher brain, but there is these reflex responses to being probed or to being irritated by some stimulus. So they will move their limbs and in response to being probed. But imagine a quadriplegic where there's no input ascending to the higher brain. They will also respond to heat. So their limbs will retract from a heat stimulus because their reflex arc circuitry is still intact and it doesn't require the higher brain. That's the fetal situation, at least in the first two trimesters. And as I mentioned just a second ago, and this is just pretty appalling, and maybe you don't know this yourself, but Dr. Condig never mentioned that the fetus is both sedated and anesthetized in the womb. So chemicals such as adenosine and a couple others are found in both human and animal fetuses, indicating that the fetus is both sedated and anesthetized. And these chemicals are oxidized when the newborn first starts to breathe. Those drugs then wash out of the tissue, and the newborn reaches full consciousness and screams like crazy because they're no longer sedated. And that gets them interacting with their new external world. But this is something that right-to-lifer groups never talk about. I don't think because it's well known that the fetus is sedated in the womb. Now, this is work that's been done by one major group, and it really needs to be backed up by other neuroscience labs, but it looks like it's pretty good work. Okay, so if we don't undermine Roe versus Wade, why is 24 weeks a reasonable time for a mother to decide whether she wants to abort or not? Well, first of all, as you can see on this graph that I've made from the Centers of Disease Control, 98% of all abortions are done before 21 weeks, and just about all abortions after that, these late-term abortions, are done because the mother discovers fetal abnormalities and the fetus is aborted. So do we really need to undermine Roe versus Wade by saying that the fetus feels pain at 20 weeks? Why else? Well, second of all babies born at 22 weeks are going to die anyway. They can't, well, not all, 93%. And those that other 7% that lives are going to have serious developmental problems. So a baby can't live outside the womb very well, if at all, before 22 weeks. So another reason is that this is around the time of quickening, which is, as I mentioned earlier, around the time that ensoulment is considered to occur in many religions. It's also the time, as I've told you, that the future neocortical neurons have migrated to the neocortical plate and are starting to develop. So now we're starting to get the higher neocortex firing up. And this 24 weeks is also well before the time the fetus has developed enough of that higher brain that it can truly suffer pain. And that's backed up by these various groups. So this approach that I've told you about is also backed up by a number of neuroscientists. Maybe the Society for Neuroscience isn't saying anything, but neuroscientists have spoken out, and this will be on my website too. So in conclusion, what have I told you about? Well, I've told you that religion provides no consensus on when personhood begins. Maybe we need to ask science about it. And as well, countries with the lowest abortion rates are more educated. They're not more religious. As well, restrictive abortion laws are not associated with lower abortion rates. That's pretty important. And that's from a study in The Lancet just 2 years ago. To reduce abortion rates, I think it's clear we need more prevention of pregnancy, so birth control, and we need more reproductive education, not more laws, particularly not governed or not legislated by politicians, most of whom have no scientific background whatsoever. So I hope I've convinced you that the acquisition of personhood is gradual and coincides with neocortical development. In the first trimester, there is no neocortex, but by the third, we have this rapid acceleration to the incredible complexity that we see in the third-term infant. And this is when the substrate for personhood is in place and flourishing. My own personal feeling is that by the time you have a third trimester fetus, if you're a mother, it's better to give birth to the fetus or to the baby. It's less trauma for the mother, and the baby has a brain that is becoming well developed. If you're going to abort, try as hard as possible to do an early term abortion. So the last thought I want to leave you with is one that's really just starting to come into fruition, and that is that neuroscience can provide insight to moral decisions. In this particular case, whether to continue your pregnancy or not. Religions do not have a monopoly on morality. Thank you.